You guys, would you like to say your names?
Jose Rivera.
Mr. Rivera, how you doing?
Chelsea Rivera.
Oh, you know each other?
Brother.
Okay, never would have guessed. I was going to say that because of the family resemblance, but I get in trouble quite a bit. Anyhow, welcome, and let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the Sabbath day. We praise you, Father, for all your blessings and seeing us here this week. We praise you, Father, for the opportunity we have to be your sons and daughters. And we ask your presence here for those who are here and those who are coming. And we pray that we do your will always. In Jesus' name, amen. I got a phone call from a fellow this week from Idaho. And he told me some very interesting news about something that's taking place in Nevada. And it's Arizona. I'm sorry. Got to get my state straight here. Yes, Arizona. Thank you, Rita. And he's going to send some information to Bill about it. But a whole group, I don't know how many or who. What I mean, well, I know who, but I don't know how many, if it's a whole conference or whatever, of Seventh-day Adventist churches have switched to keeping Sunday. Which is no big surprise, is it? We're in a time of Earth's history, folks, that is very tricky. And as Seventh-day Adventists, we need to be paying attention to our prophet. Now, I had heard reports or people who have actually heard that being taught that it doesn't matter Saturday or Sunday when you go to church. What do you suppose they're setting people up for? Let me ask you a question. How did the devil switch the sacredness from Saturday to Sunday in the third century? How did he do it? Did it happen all at once? How did it happen? How many of you read The Great Controversy? How did it happen? It just, one day they woke up and the Christian church said, we are now keeping Sunday, no more Saturday. How did it happen? Rita, go ahead.
It was gradual. They did both days for a while. They made Sabbath a burden and a drudgery, and then Sunday was a fun day. So then it wasn't hard to switch the people over.
They were keeping both days. And Chuck?
Is it so surprising, Paul, that this is happening?
No.
No. It's not surprising. We see it every day. We see it individually. We see how we're faltering. And we see what the world is doing. The world is not helping us out. It's making it worse. So it's not surprising. But the thing that is surprising, that we do not do it. That we have the strength, we have the courage of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He is protecting us and he is with us.
Well, what has been removed that people will do this? What has been removed? It's beyond removing of the Holy Spirit. This is a process. This has been going on in Adventism since the Mrs. White says since the turn of the century. When I mean not from 1900s to 2000, folks, from the 1800s. What was the alpha of apostasy? Where did our prophet say was the alpha of apostasy? Where did it really start? There was a book written by a man.
Kellogg.
By Kellogg. What was the book?
Pantheism.
Do you know that right now, what's going on in the churches is exactly what was in Kellogg's book? Did you know that? What was the name of the book? The Living Temple. And it was all pantheism. What is pantheism, folks?
God is everywhere.
But what happens when you start teaching that? What is removed from the people? Something. One word. One word. It's part of the three angels' messages, the one that's ignored. What? If you say that it doesn't matter what day is the Sabbath, do you fear God anymore? Do you fear judgment? Then you're a true Laodicean. You don't know that you're blind. You don't know that you're poor. And you don't know that you're lined up for the lake of fire. You think you're fine. See the problem? And even here, we really don't have the fear of God that we should. Oh, that word has been erased from the Seventh-day Adventist agenda, fear. There is no more fear. Yeah, Chuck?
See, we don't believe or understand what God has put upon us. We don't look at that. We don't want to. Hey, we just take it for granted that we are professed Christians and that we are doing things the way that we think God wanted us to. But we are not. We have still self, and the self is battling with God. No. Self is not thinking about God. It's thinking about what other things we can do and what other people can do for us, not God.
And that's true, Chuck, but it's beyond that. Way beyond that as a people. I read a statement last week that people who are using meat are what? What is she? I hear all the time that it's not a salvational issue. Our prophet says anybody using meat are not going to be numbered amongst the people of God. Now, let's make it real clear for all these people who want to make all these issues about the word meat and flesh. The word meat means food, period. That's what it means. Because the Bible's very clear about flesh and meat. However, we're allowing in our hospitals, what are we bringing, what do we have? Even cheese and milk, we're told that near the close, at her time, she said some of that stuff wasn't even food anymore because of the pollution in the system. Where's the fear of God? When he says, don't do that, or you're going to get cast into the lake of fire. Now, we have a 17-year-old boy going, young man, because biblically, when did a boy become a man? What age?
12
years old. When did Jesus realize what his mission was? How old was he? How did he realize it? How did he realize it? We're supposed to be tender and loving with our children, yes, but we don't lie to them. How did his father reveal to him, how many of you read The Desire of Ages? What his mission was? As he and his family and his village and his people were walking to Jerusalem to partake of the, which is very important, what did Jesus see along the road? What did he see? Crucified people, that the Roman soldiers would crucify people and hang them up on the road. Why? So people would see, ooh. Jesus realized at that point that was his lot. How old was he? 12 years old. Errol?
When he came to the temple and he saw the sacrificial system and the lamb and I saw the sheep and so forth, he realized this was his life.
His lot. Yes, it was. Anyhow, we have a 17-year-old man who took a gun, went in and shot three people to death. And what are they saying? Oh, he's disturbed. Really? The Bible tells me all those who hate God love what? We've taken this child, and I say, and we were talking about this on the way up, you drag his parents in and say, what did you do to this boy for the last 17 years? What were you putting in his head? We give unlimited access to our children to the internet, to video games, to television. What is being pumped into their heads? The fear of God? Or the lifestyle of Lucifer? And now when they, and folks, I don't care. There is no parent in here that can tell me they know what their children are doing on the internet, including me. Have you been on the internet? Do you see what's on there? They know how to get it out. We don't. Nowhere's near as good as they are. They can cover their trails, and the devil can preach. Where's the fear of God in all that? What is being taught? So we have a denomination, a people. On the borders of the promised land, what were the Israelites doing before they were going to enter? What was going on? We studied this a little while ago. What was going on? At Baal Peor, what was going on? Was the fear of God in them? What were they doing? They were intermingled with the heathen. One of the princes had taken one of the heathen princes' daughters in broad daylight, went in the camp, was fornicating. Did God say, well, you know what? He's got problems. It's okay. Is that what God said? What stopped it? The fear of God. The fear of God stopped one man, one priest, had the fear of God and upheld his law. It's going to be the same thing today. This is what we've been studying. Now, I want to go to Proverbs 3. And we see in Proverbs 3 and verse 7, be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to your navel and marrow to your bones. There's your health message. It's that simple. And we talked about that many times. Honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruits of your increase. What does that mean? What does that mean? Honor the Lord with your substance. Does that mean I just give 10% tithe? That's it? Is that what that means? And the first fruits of your labor. That's your tithe. But what does that word substance mean there? What, Chuck? Everything. What is everything? Is it my Crocs? Is it my house? Is it my children? Is it my vehicle? How about my worship? How about this church? What should we allow in here? Are we going to honor God by what we allow in here? Oh, we're a people waiting for translation. Waiting for translation, all right. So Solomon is saying here, did Solomon own anything? To this day, do you know that Solomon is still considered the most wealthy man in the world ever? Did you know that? What kind of money did he have? It was real money. It was silver. Silver's always been money. Gold has not. He had so much silver, bars and chunks of silver. He was incredibly... But when he says, honor the Lord with all that... And I find it interesting that a man that owned the world made that statement. So how much of a burden was he putting on his own self by making that statement? He owned the most prosperous, he was in charge of the most prosperous nation in the world. One that kings and queens from all around used to come to see. And he said, honor God with all that you have. Solomon said that. He wasn't a dirt poor man. So he had a lot more to give than anybody else in Israel, didn't he? As far as what he owns. I find it interesting that now the government is telling us to do that. Did you hear what they said? It's your Christian duty to give the government money so they can help the poor. Did you hear that? Dennis?
Solomon realized that what he had came from God.
Yes.
And when we come to that realization, then we would want to do the same. It's not ours. It's God's.
But what did Solomon ask God for at an early age?
Wisdom.
He didn't ask for that money, did he?
Mm-mm.
Oh, he had some problems, didn't he? He got into all kinds of stuff, didn't he? Then he wrote this. Because he called it what, Dennis? All foolishness, vanity.
Vanity.
But Solomon making that statement, and I hear these people clamoring today, all these Warren Buffetts and the like, talking about charity and gift. I wonder if they would agree with Solomon. Because you see, just like the Pharisees, they've set up these foundations and millions and tens and hundreds of millions of dollars that Gates and Buffett have put into the Clintons, put into this. Guess who controls that money? No, they do, because it's their foundation and they don't have to pay a dime tax on it. What were the Pharisees doing with the money, folks? What was the first century church doing with the money? They would come in and give these big donations, but who was controlling it? They weren't paying any taxes on it. And they had control over it. Beware. Beware. So the government has said that it is a Christian duty to pay them money so they can take care of the business. Where's God in that equation? Who are you putting your faith in? How about when the church says, oh, you need to give us all your money so we can go spread the gospel? Is that what God wants? Where's God in that equation? Who's controlling that money? And then he says in verse 10, he's coming, Chuck. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine.
X equals the unknown. X, because we don't know God. We don't know. When we put X down and then we found the equal sign, now that part of the equation we do know. But over here, we don't know all of it.
That's right.
We don't know all of it. So this is why we got to balance that formula out, the right and the left.
That's
plus
right.
And the minus go together in God's world.
Amen.
The bad and the good. Rain pours on everybody, and Jesus died for everyone.
Amen.
And that's what we don't know.
Amen. But that's a good point, Chuck. And remember, you see, I had said a few weeks ago, what is the merchandise or the money of the sanctuary? What is it? Blood. How do you move from the front of the tabernacle, and I like the tabernacle because I think if we think, and Paul always referred to the tabernacle. Did you ever notice that? He always referred to the tabernacle. I get a vivid picture in my mind. The temple, don't get me wrong, it was God's house. However, I can picture it sitting in the desert. You know what a marvelous structure it must have been? You could see it from miles away. The white sheets with the colors and the gold and the blue cords and the 10 posts holding it down. You could hear the high priests moving around from the bell and the pomegranates. You could smell and see the sacrifices. It wasn't so with the temple. When the wind blew, it would carry the aroma of the sacrifices into the camp, and the people knew. The acacia wood gave a great fragrance. I don't know how many of you have ever been around aromatic acacia wood. Very, very fragrant. The people were fully aware that even when it was packed up, that acacia wood constantly gave a fragrance, and it's a beautiful fragrance. You see? I like that. And Paul always refers to the tabernacle, doesn't he? Mobile. Move with the people. That's why we're a tabernacle. We're not to be planted in one place in some head city somewhere with thousands of people flocking in to get some kind of a blessing from some priest who doesn't even know God, may not even be a Seventh-day Adventist. We don't know. You see the problem? But this high priest is constantly moving, you see? So when they came to the door of the tent, they had blood. The priest took the blood. He brought it in. He applied the blood in the outer court. He went into the sanctuary, the holy place. He applied the blood here, there, the horns, the veil, whatever. Then, two times on one day a year, the high priest went behind the veil. Yes, I did say two. With blood. The money, the economy of the sanctuary is this. Right here. And where I'm going with that, did God give all he had to his cause? What are we holding back? Did God have fear for himself? I don't think so. But he had love for us. And the fear factor is put there so we understand that this is for real. There is blood involved. The devil wants us to shed our blood forever to the end. Solomon says we give everything we have to God and we will have great increase. Now, do we want to do that out of greed? Like Judas? Or do we do that out of the same reason he gave his son? And that is a learned process. Read.
The Bible talks about fear, and we keep talking about fear, and I know that one part of it is being afraid of something. But Webster's dictionary, the 1828 dictionary, describes fear in a way that is much more applicable. It says, the fear of God is a holy awe or reverence of God and mm-hmm. his laws, which springs from a just view and a real love of the divine character, leading the subjects of it to hate and shun everything that can offend such a holy being and inclining them to aim at perfect obedience. This is filial fear. You won't find that in the modern day Webster's dictionary, nope. But this is the way it was in 1828.
Well, that's right. But in the original definition, reverence is one of the parts of the definition. Chuck.
To go along with that, reader, it also says in the Bible, fear is the beginning of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
It's the beginning of wisdom. We don't understand what God's love is. Because we don't have any fear. Not afraid, but we don't have any respect for his word. And we just keep going along, doing our own things, and just picking what is good for ourselves. And those who have wisdom have a good understanding of what it's all about.
So it's a combination of all these things, isn't it? Anyhow, Solomon goes on to say, verse 11, my son, despise not the chastenings of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, even as a father the son in whom he delights. What is Solomon saying? There's going to be discipline. There's going to be rough road. But if you don't love your children, you don't discipline them. Is that a fact? Nowadays it's not. You have to reason with them. You have to make them understand. Well, that's in different phases. That's in different phases. But it also, Proverbs tells us, fathers, don't provoke your children to anger. It has to be done properly. We have to learn to control ourselves first. But there has to be discipline. This all works with the fear. And there has to be a respect. Was Esau upset when he realized what he had given up because he feared the Lord, or because he realized what he lost? What did Esau want? Same thing the Jews did. What did he want? The power, the wealth, notoriety that went along with his father's. He was a very powerful, influential man. That's what Esau wanted. We have to understand that when God, we have problems, and the world is teaching that if you have problems, you're not really close to the Lord. If you have money problems or whatever, you're doing something wrong and the Lord is not blessing you. Isn't that what they teach? Chuck?
When he gave up his rights, did he understand what he was giving up? Did he know what was in line for him? Not only physical things, but spiritual things.
Mrs. White said he didn't care.
And that's exactly what we're doing today. We don't care.
Yes.
That's the big headlines. We don't care.
Could you say we've sold our birthright for a mess of porridge? Could you say that? The Seventh-day Adventist Church is sold out because somebody's dangled a dollar bill. I see a lot of independents that are doing that. Going back to the conference. Why? Why? They keep their ministry going. There's no fear of God there. That's just, I'm important. That's all that is. There's no fear of God. And anytime you see that, you better run. Because the person that does that is an Esau. Make no doubt about it. The organization that does that is an Esau. A Judas. Oh, we can't say that because there's some really special people that we really hold up. What did the disciples say to Jesus? Don't you know you have offended the Pharisees? What did Jesus say? Harold?
We're talking about power in Esau. But, you know, we talk around subjects and about the topics. And, I mean, I take part in different churches and different activities. But every church I attend, I can see the weakness, the power struggle, the problems we face today in Adventism. And we're not going anywhere. We cannot get anywhere because there is an inbuilt problem only the Holy Spirit can do. And with the same Esau problem, there's quotations after quotations in the Spirit of Prophecy that says the Jewish church, Israel is an object lesson book for this modern day Seventh-day Adventist. And I want to tell you this because it's more so in independent ministry. We cannot point our finger out there because the problem is here.
Amen.
We're not facing it. You know, and next week I'm to be somewhere else to do a program. But everywhere I go, I see the problem, and we hide our head in the sand. Come on, church, we need to wake up. We need to realize the reason why Christ cannot come to this earth. And the Adventists usually say, well, it's not us, it's us. Because he's not waiting on the world. He never has waited on the world. He's been waiting on the people who profess. And so we have the problem. The story of Esau, if we're going to study, I was going to talk today about a special event, but of course I got into problems on the road and I had to pick up, we got to get Agnes and so forth so I couldn't get here. But you know something? This is God's movement, as flawed as it is, and he will correct everything in his own time.
Amen. With or without us, he's going to correct it. He will cleanse the sanctuary. We go on down to verse 13. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on Esau. I want to get on to Revelation 14:7. Go ahead, Chuck. No, say what you're going to say.
I think there was two words that you said. Tradition and tradition, and I can't think of the other one. And reputation. Tradition and reputation. We're not worried about God. We're worried about what reputation we can have and what traditions we can grab a hold of that doesn't interfere with our things that we want.
Amen. Well, I'm going to take it even a step further. I don't even think that the church cares about their reputation or tradition anymore. They just want their jobs, because otherwise we wouldn't be letting the garbage in that because it's destroying our traditions. And the reputation? What reputation does Seventh-day Adventists have in the community anymore? Oh, there's no difference. They're just like us. Only they go to church on Saturday. Have you ever heard that? I have. Dress. Theology. Diet. What traditions? What reputation? Our hospitals are serving garbage because they want to pump drugs into people and make money. That's all it's about. We were never to call them hospitals to begin with. So there's that reputation gone. So yeah, Chuck, you're right as far as that goes, and they're grabbing on to whatever they can to maintain their positioning. Go ahead, Rita.
Our reputation used to be that we were called the people of the book. Right, Dennis? Yes. Dennis. I hadn't heard that as long as I was around, and that was since 93. But that's what I remember Dennis saying. They used to call them the people of the book.
The devil's done a thorough job. However, what Errol said is very true. This thing is going to go on. And it's going to go on in God's way, with or without the professed people.
I would like to say I need to come up on higher ground. Each one of
Amen.
Us should look at us within ourselves. And I would like to quote Christ's Object Lesson, page 69. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own.
Amen.
So each one of us, it's our duty to come up on higher ground.
Amen. See, but for that to happen, the fear of God has to be placed back into the equation.
See, I'm glad you said that. I'm glad you said that, because we have a ladder to climb. We have a ladder, and each step that we take upward leads to heaven, leads to God. But we're out of shape. We're not making very many treads. And we're standing still, and we're just being either that or stepping down. And when you get to the bottom, can't go any further. So we've got to keep our step and getting on to the higher plateaus, getting on to higher grounds.
All right, verse 13. Happy is the man that finds wisdom and the man that gets understanding. Now there's that word wisdom. For the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver and gain, thereof than fine gold. So wisdom and understanding, the richest man who ever lived said, is more valuable than what? Now what wisdom is he talking about? The wisdom of the Scripture and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Because in verse 7, that's what he says. Don't be wise in your own mind, for the fear of the Lord, fear the Lord and depart from evil. So the wisdom he's talking about is not our own wisdom. Errol?
The wisdom of this world, the Bible says, is foolishness with God. So our wisdom that we have, we're so wise and conceited, is not what God's talking about. Christ has made unto us righteousness, and wisdom and redemption and salvation is made unto humanity what we cannot be or what we could never attain to. And I heard you were talking about fear. God does not want us to fear him by being that's not the God we're talking about. For we have presented that to people to tell them to fear. The fear it's talking about from the Greek is it's talking about reverence, realizing how awesome and mighty he is and how much love he's got for the human race. He's not like me and you. He's very courteous. He's so refined. He's so loving with such awesome power. No human being can have the attributes of God and be like God. Because from his office of how great he is and how humble he is, that Lucifer thought he could even have it power over the Godhead. You see? So we do not, unless we have the very mind and character and life of Christ, we can make it. And so that's a problem. Our selfishness, our ego, and all that stuff is in. All that has to be eroded by the Holy Spirit and by the blood. And so the thing is, the fear of God is reverence. And when we teach young people that, and get to realize that Christ humbled himself all the way. He went straight down past Calvary to the second death, where nobody can go and come back, at the risk of failure and eternal loss, to redeem us, realize how much he loved us. We don't love people, really.
Let me read the definition of fear again here, folks, as it is written by Solomon. Yes, love and reverence, that's all you ever hear. However, there is a penalty for not keeping God's law. That's where the rest of it. Let me read the definition again. And we talked about this last time. The Roman Catholic Church did a very good job of painting God as some ogre, wanting to destroy and kill and no. That's one side, but what naturally happens with an extreme? What happens? It snaps back to the other side. It says here, this word in the Hebrew, to fear morally, to frighten, afraid, be afraid of, dread, of one who can produce an effect. That's the word that's being used here. To reverence, to be in reverence of, to tremble at. Remember we talked about when Moses came up on the flaming bush? What was he told to do? Why? What would have happened if he didn't? He would have died. He knew God was not kidding. The church does not realize that God is not playing. That portion of the fear has been removed. That's why Solomon used that word. Oh, God loves me. I respect and reverence him. He's not going to hurt me. Is that what Jesus said on the cross? Is that what he said? When he said, I've condemned it in hell? Is that what he said? Oh, he never said that. Yes, he did. It is finished means it is finished, but it also means I've condemned it in hell. What did he condemn in hell on Calvary, folks? I thought it was all just an act of love. What did he condemn in hell? What is hell? Like a fire. What did he condemn in hell at Calvary? Was he the judge? So the judge said, it's condemned to an eternal death if you do not, what? We went over all this. What's going to happen to the people that put him to death? What's going to happen to them? You see, folks, we can't lose. The church has lost. Those Pharisees that put him to death had no fear of God whatsoever.
The problem is that we don't fear God because, unfortunately, we think he's playing a game. And that it's just that life is just a game. Life is just a party. Life is just, it's all about fun, loving God, and sitting back and reading the Bible and having some Jesus. And that's it. And unfortunately, it's dry. It's completely dry. And that's going to be the path to death. It's not going to be a path of life because we don't fear God. We don't respect him. And without that respect and acknowledgement that this is not a game, This is our eternal life. This is our salvation. This is us at hand. That if we don't realize the true nature of his awesomeness and his power, we're going to be lost. We're going to lose the quote-unquote game that we think that it is.
Did Jesus make a statement to that effect about people? Chuck and then Agnes. Did Jesus make a statement to that effect? What did he say when he said, many will come in that day and say, have we not done this and done that in your name? What was removed out of that equation? Number one, they did it on their own terms, correct? So where was the fear of God? Oh, but he loves me. They even went to him and said, no. You have to do it the way I tell you, because what happened to those people? What did he say to happen to them? Into the outer darkness, where there'll be gnashing of teeth and wailing.
You see,
we have to be careful.
We do not understand what happened on the cross at Calvary, or what happened to the person beside the thief on the cross. He was living in his last hour. He knew that.
Yes.
But he didn't say these things because he was afraid of what. He said them because they were true. He had witnessed just being on the cross and throughout his life what Christ was. But other people, they decided to really drag him apart. And that's what happened. He died the death of a real criminal. But when Christ heard his voice, he must have heard something in there that the man really meant. And he was saved.
Agnes, what do we tell a small child when they do something wrong? Do we warn them?
Oh, I'm sorry.
And say, no, you shouldn't do that. Now, if they do it again, what do we do? Warn them, say, no, mommy loves you, dad, don't do that again. And if they do it again, what do we do? What is that child thinking at that point? Ah, that's a bunch of baloney. Where's the fear of the parent? Where is the fear? It's the same thing with the church. Remember, Solomon said he's going to discipline and chasten. I'm not saying God's a big ogre. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm also, do not remove the disciplinary action away from the love. What does the rainbow that's over the ark represent? Two things. Justice and mercy. They go hand, fear of God. They go hand in hand. Agnes?
My question is about fearing God. And I just want an answer. I want it to be clarified. Because most times when we say fear God, Most of us, including myself, people think, be afraid of him because of the judgment that will come to you if you don't. But my understanding is more than fearing him is to love him to the degree where I would trust him in every situation, regardless of whatever the circumstance may be. So I have a problem with when we are told to fear God, to be trembling and he's going to snap me out or whatever.
See, this is the work of the theologians. They've done a very good job. It has to be a combination. It has to be a combination.
Good morning.
It has to be with your parents. Did you do exactly what you wanted, when you wanted, because you feared them, because you just loved them? Or did you know there was a consequence for your actions? Why do we forget the consequence when we say the word fear? Because we've been taught to do that. Why is the word fear used in the three angels' messages? What's Jesus trying to say? Well, what's God trying to say? Because he was the messenger. I'm not saying, and this is the way, the mindset of how we've been taught. God's a mean ogre. Oh, he's going to do this. And we talked about this before. Did Pharaoh fear God? Where is he? Where is he going to be? I told you, they found the mummy at the time of the Exodus of a pharaoh that had traces of salt water in his body, and he drowned in the Red Sea. Did Pharaoh fear? Who is this God that I should listen to him? Is that what he said? Moses was trying to tell him, you better fear him. Moses loved and reverenced God greatly. Moses was a man that could go to God and say, Lord, do you realize what you're doing? There's going to be great reproach on your name if you do that. If Moses was just thinking that God was going to strike him down for going against them, Jesus, why did he say that? Because it was a. We don't have that combination today, otherwise we wouldn't be the way we are. It's not one or the other. It's got to be a blend. Harold?
You know, the foundation of God's throne is mercy and justice.
Mm-hmm.
And we do not understand his mercy, number one. We do not understand his justice. We do not understand the third angel's message, which is supposed to be preached in our time. It began in the 1888 message, was rejected by our own brethren. Two streams of theology came out of there. And we still have two streams of theology in the church today. You know, I usually hear people tell their little kids, say, you know, if you don't obey or behave yourself in church, God won't love you because you're bad. But is that true?
No.
No, it's a lie, because God loves you. We should be telling the little child how to obey. Show them how to obey and say, God loves you whether we are good or bad, and but he wants you to be good. The next thing is this, that the third angel message is not understood. So we preaching some message which is not a compilation, a mix-up of what was taught by Butler, G.I. Butler, and by these men, and reject what N.G. White and Jones and Wagner has presented, which what is the message for this time. The next thing is that we're talking about fear, and we do not realize Voltaire. Does his name ring a bell to anybody?
Uh-huh.
Voltaire was a Catholic young man. Wanted to go into be a priest and all of that. And when he listened to how they preach about hell and about God, he decided if that's the way God is, he can be there by himself. Because I don't believe in a God who is such a tyrant. Jesus came to this planet, took on flesh and blood to reveal what God is like. I tell you, we need to go and have a revelation of what Jesus is like before we present what God is like. Because we don't know what God. God is not like Errol Evans, and he's not like you, and he's not like me. And it's about time. I've been to other churches where historic professed churches, the same legalistic attitude. We need to understand what God is like. He is not like us. And this attitude that we're driving people and driving our young people out of the church. You see, we need to realize mercy and justice, and how he blends it. Until we understand the third angel message and justification by faith and the righteousness of God, we're not presenting his love.
I will say this. If you're walking with God, do you need to worry about his judgments? Do you? So there has to be an understanding there. Now, even in Revelation 14, guys, we're out of time. Even in Revelation 14, in verse 7, it says, say with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and sea and the fountains of water. Which message is that? It's the first message. That word fear that is used there, and this is written to who? Who's it for, this message? Who was it for? Why did he say that? That word fear in the Greek. Fear, to frighten, to be alarmed, afraid, exceedingly afraid, to reverence. We have a problem with that. Why would he say that to the church? Do we have a church that no longer has that fear? And I agree with what Errol said. I've seen it too. Frighten the kids. No. That's not the fear that's being spoken of. frighten the people. There is a recompense. There will be a discipline. But when that is moved away from, we end up with what we have today. Anything goes. God doesn't care. Doesn't matter what day you go to church on. Saturday, see the problem? And it's interesting to me that as Seventh-day Adventists, we don't understand that concept. That it's got to be one or the other. Now, I don't know how people were raised or brought up. I don't know what they heard when they were young in the churches. This has a great influence on how you understand these words. And no, we don't know the mind of God. He has said that. But this first angel's message, which was given to the churches, says fear God and worship him according to the way he said to. Because there's going to be a recompense for those who didn't. Jesus went into the temple with a whip. Once? Twice. What did people do? Did they laugh at him when he did it? Say, who are you kidding? What happened? Some of the most influential and powerful men in the nation at that time did what? Why? He scared them. Did the people run? What did they find when they came back after their fear of physical or whatever they thought was going to happen to them disappeared? What did they find? They found Jesus teaching the people. See, folks, there's the balance. If we're walking with Christ, what part of fear are we going to understand more than the other? The reverence, the love, the duty. If we're not, the other part's to get our attention. There is going to be an end to this. And what he says is final. God does mean what he says. And just because you claim to be a Seventh-day Adventist does not mean you're going to heaven. See, to me, that's the balance. If I've got fear of what God's going to do to me, is my life in the condition it should be? Did Paul worry about that? After his conversion? No. Well, even before that, he was very dedicated to his task. Did Jesus worry about what his father was? And his father did do it to him. Wow, figure that one out. Now, you want to see a twist. Look at him hanging on the cross. Who allowed that to happen? For me. For my sins. But was Jesus afraid of his father? He did everything, not my will, but your will be done. Because he knew that all things come together. Do what? For good. And they glorify the Father. You see? We need to stop worrying about what we're going to receive and get where we need to be and get about our Father's business. You run into Seventh Day, it's one or the other they're afraid of. It's got to be a blend. Was Paul afraid to go to death? Peter? Was John? After their conversions? Any of these people? Isaiah? Joshua? Stephen? We need to stop. And the church has said, oh, don't preach the three angels' messages. What's this going to bring? More afraid of man than who? God says, if you don't do that, what's going to happen? Who are you going to believe? So who does the church believe, God or man? Who is the church afraid of? Because for decades they've been teaching what Errol just said, taking a little kid from a little... Oh, if you don't fear God, he's not going to love you. The devil knows what he's doing. The devil knows exactly what he's doing. So then we have a church now that is more afraid of losing their, as Chuck said, their place in the world than serving their head. So folks, I don't know what you're going to come away with from here, but I want to make it perfectly clear. I am not saying God is some mean ogre. That's not the point. It has to be a blend. And if we're walking with Christ, the other end doesn't matter. This is what we're to project to people. There will be an end to this. It is not going to continue the way it is. And either we're part of the problem or part of the solution. We don't want to be part of the problem. Jesus said, I read the text, don't fear man who can kill the body. Who did he say to fear? Who can fear him who can do what? Into hell. And as Seventh-day Adventists, we know this, and we're to be warning the world, not worrying about these points and trying to disprove the fact that God is some ogre. We do that by living the life Christ did. The rest of it doesn't matter. Does that make sense? But God will do what he says. That's the point, I think. Let's pray. We're out of time. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, and as it's been said here, we don't know you. As much as you have tried, Father, help us individually and personally to get to know you and to live like your Son did, and to do your will, to focus, Father, on your love for us and on the sacrifice that you made for us, and to go do the same for others, to best of our ability and within our powers that you have granted us to do this work. Help us to overcome, Father, and to be the church triumphant, Father, and not to succumb to the things of this world. We praise you and thank you for the Sabbath day. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Amen.